Hi folks, this video summarizes a DIY design and construction of an air cleaner for laser cutters. The concept is shown in this diagram. Basically, three units that stack on top of each other. The bottom units is where the smoke and fumes enter from the laser cutter, and large particles drop to the bottom by gravity. Second chamber, which rests on top of this bottom chamber, has a series of filters which will essentially hold back small particles and chemicals that are in the air laser fumes. And the last chamber on the top is where a strong fan is located. A centrifugal blower will pull the air from the laser cutter through the filter and then eject it out into the external atmosphere. The finished product turned out to be quite impressive. I was a bit surprised, actually. You can see the three chambers that rest on one another, and the whole system rests on wheels, so it's easy to move around. Each chamber can be rotated independently from the other chamber, so you can change the direction of the input and output vents, which turned out useful. And I'd obviously put drawer handles on each cube to help lift the cubes to rotate, as well as to change filters and for maintenance. I'd also made a window vent plate so that the air cleaner outlets can be attached to the window pane and not look too shabby. The performance of the final system with all the filters is pretty outstanding. It was getting around 18 to 20 meters per second flow rate. I haven't done a smoke test in this video, but I had done one later, which I'll show hopefully in a different video. The system is reasonably quiet compared to commercial units that are used at maker centers, which are irritatingly loud. And this buzzing sound you see in this video, here in this video, is from that from the meter, from the anemometer, which kind of measures the speed of the flow. The first step to make this whole system was to make a box for the air blower. I'd acquired a couple of blower fans from an auction, which would form the heart of this unit. If I were to buy these blowers new, I think they cost around $500 or so each. The motor on these blowers was marked at 200 volts, and the wiring had UK wire code colors. The fans did run on 110 volts AC, but for the full output, I would need 200 volts AC. Each fan was about 12 inches wide, so a 15-inch cube would hold one of the fans with space for the air to enter and for the electrics to be attached. So this helped me decide, you know, the overall size of the system. Essentially, a 16-inch vertical cylinder, rectangular cylinder, I guess. I used white melamine shelving boards. These were just less than 15.75 inches wide. The four sides of the boxes were assembled by butt joints, which were held with glue and screws. You know, this has worked well for me, so I do not use complex finger joints or anything else. So for the fan, the box that contains the blower fan, the topmost box, I decided to create two output vents, and these would be circular, so I could attach them to the window vent. And I found an incredible solution at the local home improvement stores. I found these two plastic toilet flanges that were 4 inches outside diameter, which is the standard for vents or so for smoke vents. And they cost only around $4 each. So I used these. So what I did was I cut holes in the side of the box, around 5-inch diameter circles. And then I would be attaching these vents to these circles in the side. I'd also attach the drawer handles, and you can see the washers on the two sides which hold the drawer handles. Then to attach the fan to this to the inside of this box, I used scrap pieces of wood to kind of fill the gaps between the metal lips of the fan and the sides of the box. The blower would eject the air through the two holes which I've described before. The top of this fan, as seen here, will be covered with a 16-inch square piece of melamine forming the top of the box. Here I am just cutting the 15-inch square as carefully as possible. And then I attach the top into the sides with just standard glue and screws. You can see three metal screws on the top. These went into the metal top of the fan to kind of help hold it in place too. So that was it for making the chamber for the fan. The next section is about connecting the electricals in for this box. The fan was a 200 volt unit, as I mentioned before. So I had to harvest 110 to 200 volt transformer to, you know, get maximum efficiency for this fan. In this diagram, I've summarized the way I wired the fan. It's pretty simple, but essentially the live and neutral wires from the IEC power socket were connected to a two pole power switch. This power switch actually had a light to show on, which I was not aware till I finally wired the whole thing in. The brown light from the power switch was connected to the transformer's black 110 volt input, and the blue neutral from the power switch was connected to the white neutral on the transformer. The blue neutral wire was also connected to the fan neutral. So basically the transformer is now fed with 110 volt input, and it has different outputs, 200 to 240 volts. So I decided to use the 200 volt output. So I connected that black 200 volt output to the live of the fan. So the neutral forms the common between the fan and the switch and the IEC AC input, and the transformer jumps up the live to 200 volts. All the earth connections were tied to a single point on the transformer as shown here. So on coming back to the mechanical stuff, so I cut holes in the sides of the box to attach the power switch on one side and an IEC AC input socket on the opposite side. Like I mentioned before, I had to look up the UK color code. Blue is for neutral, brown is for live, and green is for earth. The recycle socket that I had had already wires attached to it, but it didn't seem to match the standard. So I had to kind of bridge the colors, if you know what I mean. And the fan came with a power cord, so I reused sections of it to complete the wiring. In this image, the IEC AC input is visible on the left. The transformer is on the right with the power switch just below it. The transformer was attached to the wood panel with nuts and bolts. And there was a rubber pad, which I later wedged in between the fan and the top of the transformer. Wiring to the power switch you can just see on the left. Once the wiring on the blower box was completed, I tested it to make sure it works, and relief, yes, it worked pretty well. Then the next step was making the bottommost chamber in my stack of three chambers. I'd already now completed the fan with the electrics. So now the bottommost is my work on next. This would be where the fumes come in from the laser cutter. The box was assembled just like before, four sides and a bottom. The only difference was this box was 7 inches high compared to the fan box, which was around 15 inches in height. I cut, like before, a hole, one single hole into the side of this bottom box, and then attached the toilet flange as the vent. Yeah, used just caulking and screws. Added the drawer handles and then glued a wooden lip to the top edge. This was a plastic molding which was made to look like wood, and this would help keep the enclosures from sliding off when I stacked them on top of each other, and also help create an airtight seal between the bottom, middle, and the top boxes. Then in the next stage, I went on to kind of the most complicated aspect, making the enclosure that would hold the filters. This rectangular cylinder was open on the bottom and the top, and it is 12 inches high. Now this would bridge the bottom input vent chamber and the top blower chamber. I added a wooden lip to the top of this box to create the airtight seal with the blower box, which should be on top of it. So for the filters, I decided to use a three-stage filtration approach. First filter, which would be closest to the bottom box, would remove the large particles with a matted filter pad and remove chemicals with a mixture of activated charcoal and regular charcoal. The second set of filters on top of this would remove smaller particles with regular home air furnace filters. And then the last filter set would be removing the really small particles with a HEPA filter. The staged approach also extends the life of the more expensive HEPA filter, because hopefully you've held most of the junk in the earlier filters. I had at home 14-inch square furnace filters and a few smaller HEPA filters from a clean air system. I joined the 5-inch wide HEPA filters together. They were 5-inch by 15. So I joined the 5-inch ones together with airtight joints to create a larger HEPA filter, a 15-inch square HEPA. And then this HEPA was wedged into the top of the box, so it kind of wedged against the wooden lip that I had at the top of this box. Then below the HEPA would be the regular furnace air filters. I wish I had 15-inch square, which would definitely simplify the construction. I could have just wedged them in below the HEPA. But because these were 14, I had to make a frame which would bridge the gap between 14 and 15 inches. And the frame was made out of cheap white wood. I used strips of double-sided foam tape to form a barrier, and then attach two of these air filters that had glued together before to this foam barrier. The logic of using two filters instead of one is that you get a major improvement if you stagger two filters. And then what I did was, once the frame was ready, I pushed the frame in with the two filters resting against the HEPA filter. And then I held this whole frame in place with the shipping tape. So when I have to remove it, I guess I would have to cut the tape and slide it out. The bottommost filter, which would contain the kind of filter pad and the carbon filters, would be made out of a box in a way. This box I made out of 3.5 inch wide MTF. So I had a four-sided, square cylinder. The bottom of this box I covered with fiberglass window mesh and metal grid that is used for stucco walls, so pretty cheap. The mesh and grid were held onto the MDF sides with screws. And then the blue filter wedge, which I bought from the home improvement store, was wedged into the bottom of this box against the mesh. This would essentially form a pre-filter to hold the big stuff. I had prepared a cloth rectangular bag, which was slightly larger than the inside of this box, the filter box. I guess a pillowcase it would be a simplest way to describe it. And then filled it with a mixture of regular crushed charcoal that had been autoclaved and commercial activated charcoal granules. Unfortunately, I lost the images for these. So I'll have to either reshoot another video, so when I make a brand new filter, replacement filter. The top of the box was covered with another piece of metal grid, again held with screws. So I basically made a box. Bottom was open, but with mesh and grid. The top was covered with grid. And inside the box were the filter mat and the pillow of charcoal. I also attached metal eyelets and a nylon tape to serve as a handle on the bottom of this box. I can slide it in and out. The assembled box was slid inside and attached to the sides with a screw coming from the outside of the enclosure into the MDF box. So now to remove this, I would have to essentially remove the screws and pull the box out with its kind of handles. That is, hopefully it'll work when I go to change the filter. Then the last thing was more for cosmetic than any other reason. I made a nice looking window vent to attach the air filter to. So I bought two of these clothes dryer vents, again from our favorite home improvement store. They cost a bit more than I expected, around $10 each. I measured the size of the opening of the window and then cut a white plywood shelf panel. And then in this panel, I cut 4.25 inch diameter holes with a jigsaw, and then attached the two vents into the holes with corks and screws. I had to trim the metal cylinders that came with the vent because they were a bit too long. And then to this panel, I also glued some rubber window seals. So when it rests in the window, it creates a relatively tight seal. And then I placed this window panel in place. Finally, I brought all the pieces together, the stack of three filters and the kind of window panel, connected the output from this the filter box into the window panel with these kind of metal tubes. Overall, pretty happy. It works well. Had done a smoke test, which I have to re-record. Sorry, didn't record it when I did it. So what would I do different? I think the biggest headache is the smart idea of having a stack of three cubes is actually a bit of a pain, because to change filters or to empty the bottom cabinet with granular stuff, I have to lift everything off and then empty and then again restack the boxes. In the future, if I was to make this again, I would make the cabinet with a door in the front so that the filters and fans can be easily accessed. This will be a challenge to kind of get airtight seals, but I think it's still doable. Hopefully, this construction made a bit of sense for you, and thanks for watching. Bye.